talk about the zombie apocalypse versus international health regulations, introducing a very important piece of international law and how to circumvent it. Florian, that's your stage.
Thank you very much. Thanks for your kind introduction, and also to you for coming so early in the morning at 1 o'clock. And special thanks to my friend Dan, who borrowed me his computer. I mean, I know it's a computer conference, but I didn't bring my computer with me. I also have to start with a huge disappointment. I mean, remember when you found out the truth about the Easter Bunny and Father Christmas? Zombies are not real. They are characters of imagination. However, I will assume for the rest of my talk that they are real, and also that the apocalypse started less than 12 hours ago, or not yet. And if you're more interested in what happens afterwards, I would like to refer you to the many documentaries out there. There are also interactive training environments on your computer. But we just pretend that it hasn't started yet. And infectious diseases always ignore borders, and there have been analyses from the Stone Age where you could show that the causative agent of plague, Yersinia pestis, was moving from the areas we now call Asia to the areas we now call Europe. And they found it by analyzing the caveman teeth. And in more recent times, we had in Europe devastating epidemics. Recent time means the 19th century. We had devastating cholera epidemics. And it's the kind of epidemics you have now in civil war-torn Yemen, where you have over 700,000 cases and over 1,000 deaths. And cholera is really serious. Here now in our camp environment, if we had untreated cholera, about 50% of us would die. So they would die, probably. And this is why people the governments came together to discuss how to introduce rules to combat infectious diseases. And especially after the Second World War, when the United Nations were founded, the WHO, the World Health Organization, was founded, and they started with the first iterations of the international health regulations. In 1969, they had an update, and the goal was to monitor cholera, plague, yellow fever, smallpox, and some other diseases. However, these were defined diseases, because at that time, we still thought that we know everything about bacteria, everything about diseases, so you didn't have unknown threats in there. And the diseases that are underlined are the ones that had to be notified, which essentially means that if you are a nation state and you say, I have cholera, then your neighbors start implementing trade controls and travel controls. So it's a disincentive from saying, oh, I have cholera. There were a lot of notifications which were saying, oh, we have an outbreak of watery diarrhea, which of course was cholera, but they didn't call it this way. Then there was an epic fail in 2003, SARS came, and it started in mainland China. And fortunately, there was an infectious disease network, the influenza network. They picked up a lot of people that became ill with respiratory diseases. And still, the H1N5 threat is it's basically the thing that scares everyone. And at first, they thought that now they have a very, very dangerous influenza pandemic starting up. You had cases in the Philippines, you had cases in Vietnam. And it spread very, very quickly. The costs here are only the cost to food and travel. It's not the human tragedy which you see here. And the situation was really, really bad up until April 2003, when the Chinese government changed and Hu Jintao became president. Then the corporation the cooperation of between mainland China and WHO and other countries improved. And when you go back here, SARS wasn't on this list. So China didn't do anything wrong. They didn't break any international laws. Fortunately, a miracle happened. And all the people who had really good ideas all the years before, who were not heard, all the public health epidemiologists, they got together. Iran and United States were sitting on a negotiation table. You had Pakistan, India, all the classic enemies coming together and making up new rules. And the international health regulation came into force in 2007. And its purpose, its primary purpose, of course, is to prevent and combat the cross-border health threats. This does include chemical, radiological, and biological incidents. And it's important that it is a cross-border threat. So as long as the epidemic is in your own country, the international health regulations don't apply. But the moment it becomes a threat to infect other countries or people living in other countries, the international health regulations get triggered. It also has an important point in protecting human rights and human dignity. And for example, in the 2014 Ebola intervention, it became very, very important to provide dignified burials, because you had people who became sick of Ebola, they died, and it became very important to keep the local population still engaged with the intervention team, so you needed dignified burials. And this is still an issue now in the current Ebola outbreak in the Democratic Republic of Congo, in the north of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Then, since its governments agreeing to regulations, you have to respect the national sovereignty. And the last point, you need to avoid unnecessary impairment to international travel and, of course, trade. I'm coming to the zombies in a few moments. Mainly, the international health regulation contain codified responsibilities, so things that a state, things that a government needs to organize in order to fulfill those responsibilities. And we have the chemical, biological, radiological threats. When you think of Chernobyl would qualify for a radiological health threat. It's a cross-border health threat, or it was a cross-border health threat. And a lot of the things that are in the regulations deal with structural requirements. So you need to have surveillance capabilities, and surveillance here is something positive. So it's not evil state invading your privacy, it's good public health protecting you from infectious diseases. And I just read the email this morning that the surveillance team, Fachgebiet 32 from the RKI Robert Koch Institute, is watching this stream as well. It also deals with notification chains. For example, if you get diarrhea here, and a lot of people would get diarrhea here, the local health department of this Kreis would call the state health department. I work for a state health department in another part of Germany, and they get a notification and they notify the federal agency. So you need infrastructure. I will talk about the border checkpoints later. Another important tool is the Public Health Emergency of International Concern. It's kind of DEFCON 5 in the movies, you know, the war game movie, movie war game, DEFCON 5. And it's quite simple. The moment you have a public health risk that could also spread to other countries, and the moment it requires a coordinated international response, they call out this Public Health Emergency of International Concern. Examples would be the still ongoing polio eradication. Our huge influenza pandemic in 2009 was a fake, well, not a fake, but how do you pronounce this in English? Fake? Well, okay. And the Ebola 2014 was one, and the very recent ongoing Ebola outbreak 2019 was also a public, or is a public health emergency of international concern. And now this is taken completely out of context, I know. But the first sentence they have is that the WHO legal department and the Department of Compliance, Risk Management and Ethics. So they briefed someone, because I was thinking it's like a medical emergency, but they start with the Department of Compliance and legal, with the legal department. So now you are asking yourself, where do the zombies come in? Plan 9 from outer space had aliens who were chemically triggering the pituitary gland of recently deceased humans, and they crawled from their grave and did their thing. The classic Night of the Living Dead had a space probe from Venus which was sort of radioactive, and this triggered all the zombies. And the more plausible Resident Evil World War Z or 28 Days Later, it was a biological agent. Now, 28 Days Later was very, very special because it was a movie about an epidemic spiraling out of control during a time when an epidemic was spiraling out of control, during SARS. And when you think of this in terms of cosmic ripple effects, like the butterfly effects, I'm really sure that presenting this SARS threat in a sort of movie where politicians can go to makes it explainable to them so that they actually do something. And it was a coincidence that 28 Days Later coincided with SARS, but I'm very sure that it helped to help the politician to grab the seriousness of the situation they were in. So the, what's the Halbzeit score? The halftime, yeah, the halftime score for the international health regulations is nil, zero. And I have to say this, there are epidemiological plot holes in the movies. Because in epidemiology, you have exposure and outcome. So like you smoke cigarettes, you increase your risk of dying from lung cancer, or you more likely die from coronary heart disease. However, dying from coronary heart disease has no feedback on smoking. With infectious disease epidemiology, the outcome is the exposure. So you have nonlinear effects. Translating this into zombie movies, there's no way a zombie can sort of increase the radioactivity, or that a zombie can increase the chemical exposure to something, because this is a linear effect here. Only with biological agents you can have this epidemic spreading out. So did we miss anything? Of course. This gentleman shows us that the WHO missed completely necromancy. I wanted to make this as a sort of hacker contest or nerd contest, sorry, no hacker, a nerd contest, so for you to name them. I'm skipping that, but who can tell me and shout it out, who can tell me who the most dangerous necromancer is here? It's not the White King, it's not the White King. Who is the most dangerous one? Shout out. My son did know the answer, and he's 8 years old, when I was asking him when he was bringing him to sleep. Okay, it's the woman on the top right. It's Liliana Vess from Magic the Gathering. She's a planeswalker, so her basic ability is to walk between different planes. So she's the one most likely to be able to come here. And if you see her, call the Gatewatch, please. Anything else? we have the Eurovision Song Contest. This is not playing now. Hold on. Wait a second. What did I do? Okay, yeah. Eurovision Song Contest, Lordi, Hard Rock Hallelujah. It's actually my favorite part in the video. You have this poor heavy metal fan who gets dissed by everyone, and now she's getting her own zombie entourage from the cheerleaders. And this clearly shows that heavy metal can create zombies. So heavy metal as a threat, it's not an international health regulation. So we have two serious fails here. And the score is now a little bit better for the zombies. And this is a bit of a joke, but I have to introduce you into a very important rule, the Beamtenregel Nummer 1, Zuständigkeit prüfen. And this is part joke, part serious. But when you work as a Beamter, like I do, very often people want something from you. People want you to work. And if you can somehow make the point that it's not your department, it's not your jurisdiction, it's not your Zuständigkeit, well, you know, you would like to help, but not my Zuständigkeit. So translating this to the international health regulations, the chemical, biological, radiological zombies are covered, but the necromantic and the heavy metal zombies are not covered. And translating this into a real world a problem is the current invasion of the Asian tiger mosquito in Germany. It's an important disease vector, and it's a little mosquito which is right now invading Germany. And you have the environmental agencies who are usually in charge of, well, like rats and animals and also mosquitoes. And they keep saying, well, it's not our business because it's a health problem. So it's the health department's problem. The health department's problem says, well, no, it's an environmental problem. So in the end, nothing gets done really, and it's a really it's a real problem of agencies not cooperating and not working with each other. And so yes, Zuständigkeit prüfen is a problem. Let's talk about this algorithm on page 43 in Annex 2 of the international health regulations. And it basically determines whether or not you need to make a notification to the WHO. So all this algorithm comes down to a yes-no decision: shall I notify WHO or not? If the answer is yes, you have a nice notification form. You will see this is a German form, and that is because, as I said earlier, every nation state has the responsibility to translate the international health regulation in national law. In Germany, it's called Internationale Gesundheitsvorschriften Durchführungsverordnung, or Gesetz. No, I think it's a Gesetz. You can say, well, yes, you know, here we have a other threat, so it's not smallpox, it's zombie apocalypse, and you can say something, and you have to fax it. There's a fax number, and I think the fax number is hooked up to some email account, but the German law stipulates, well, if you trigger a notification, you need to fax it to them. And it's not the commoners who send it, it's the health departments who send it. And the new algorithm is almost backwards compatible. You see the yellow diseases, which were also present in the version 2. This is International Health Regulation version 3. It also has plug-ins. SARS is in it now. But most importantly, they added something: health threats of unknown causes or sources or other events. So this would be the algorithm for zombies. We have an event detected, and it's an unknown cause. It's serious health impact, having zombies coming to your home. It's unusual and unexpected, so yes, we need to notify it. However, that's not always the case. In World of Warcraft, Undercity, that's the place where it's a scourge, isn't it? The undead live there. So, I mean, zombies are undead, and undead living in an undead city is nothing unusual. So it's not unexpected. And let's just assume for a second that all the undead of World of Warcraft stay there, and they don't impede travel or trade, then the notification is not triggered, because it's nothing unusual. A real-world example would be measles. In the Ukraine, measles is... they have so many measles cases. It also has to do with the civil war in Ukraine. But they have so many measles cases that if you were traveling by plane to the Ukraine, you would not trigger the international health regulations. However, if you were traveling to the United States, which are certified measles-free, they have an official certification as a measles-free, not region, but state, yes, this would trigger a notification. And the United States will lose their measles-free certificates this October, most probably, because they have an ongoing measles outbreak, which is now ongoing for over a year. And it certainly does not help that President Trump is an anti-vaxxer. And let's talk about zombies crossing at points of entry. There is a paragraph 20, which says that the state parties, which means the governments, need to tell the WHO where they port, so their shipping ports, international shipping ports, and international airports, which of those airports have the capabilities to deal with an international with a highly infectious disease case. The same is for ground crossings, but let's focus on the planes, on the airports, and on the ports. This is again an example from Germany. And as I said before, the international health regulations are about capacity building. So these are the airports in Germany which have this capability, and the ports. And should you be anywhere in the world and have a highly infectious disease which could wipe out humanity, the best thing would be to jump into an active volcano. If we were married and I wanted you to survive, I would recommend that you book a plane ticket to Frankfurt and just, like, you know, sit in the far corner of the airplane. And before you land, like 3 hours before you land, you tell the stewardess that you just came from a tropical region and then you have like high fever and you're not feeling well and you think you might have something really serious. That gives them enough time to get ready and to put you into their biosafety level 4 hospital there. The hospital... The hospital is really, really good, but it took so long to build, and it was built for smallpox eradication, but it had so much red tape, and it took so long to build that once it was finished, smallpox was eradicated already. But it's still there, and they have really nice tools, and the local health department in Frankfurt, they are hard as nails, and they're really one of the best. So, what happens when you have zombies on a plane? The passenger locator card. Let's say you have an event or you have someone with an infectious disease in an airplane. You get these cards for contact tracing. So all the passengers will get these cards so that you can follow them up. The only question here is whether the zombies will eat you before or after they got these cards. But contact tracing is really important. It's actually one of the most important tools. On the top left, You see the contact tracing that was done by my colleagues Lutz and Maya during a Lhasa incident in Germany. It was the first Lhasa transmission outside of Africa. And the goal is to trace the contact, to get them into, to observe whether or not they get sick, to get them in, to give them treatment, and to make sure that you don't get more infectious contacts. The graph on the top right is our tuberculosis outbreak from 2007, but the more important graph is the one on the bottom. It's the Ebola outbreak in 2014 in Nigeria, and let me just very quickly say that nobody so far was able to do what Nigeria did. It was absolutely amazing. You have 190 million people, country. You have an ill person with Ebola who, against the advice of the doctor, came to a 21 million people city. And the person lied about his Ebola exposure. And the Nigerian epidemiologists, they had over 18,000 visits. They had over almost 900 contacts. And they found 20 cases. Unfortunately, 8 cases died. But within almost only a month, they managed to stop Ebola in their country. And this is absolutely fantastic. And yes, let's quickly talk about the travel and trade loophole, because you know, the moment you avoid restrictions, you see this point in the flowchart. The moment you are able to avoid restrictions, and you avoid notification, and when you take a closer look at the paragraph 43, it basically says that you as the sovereign state are allowed to make your own laws as long as your own laws are not more restrictive than reasonably available alternatives that would achieve the appropriate level of health protection. Now, what is reasonably available, what is appropriate? And if you are a good lawyer, you can help this in an infinite loop. So my final verdict is a draw between zombies and the international health regulations. And if you really want to hack the international health regulations, you should either establish a cross-border trading empire, zombie organs, for example, and hire many, many lawyers. You could also take up necromancy lessons. Usually in death magic, the first spell is always raise dead. And there are a lot of instructions on the internet. Or you could just join a heavy metal band. And yes, again, special teams, thanks to Dan from Team 23 here. Yeah, that was it.
Florian, that was quicker than expected, which gives us some more time for the Q&A session. So,
wonderful.
Hopefully your friends in the Robert Koch Institute found the chat button and will come up with some serious difficult questions now. Do we have something from the internet? I don't see a signal over there, no. Do we have questions here from the people in the tent?
Hi. You mentioned the heavy metal example, but you could also see it as the anti-vaxxers movement that goes from state to state.
I didn't get your question.
The anti-vaxxers movement.
Yes.
That is also popular culture, in a sense, that moves from state to state.
Yes, that's true. This would you said the anti-vaccination movement.
Yes.
This is a threat. It's a threat for vaccine-preventable diseases. Nobody in the Republic of Congo is arguing about the Ebola vaccine. Oh, usually, that's what my knowledge is. But you are right that the anti-vaxxing movement in especially rich countries like United States, also like Germany, that this leads to the lack of herd immunity. And if you do not have herd immunity, then those people who cannot get vaccinated, like children under 1 year, like people with immune diseases, like older people, like people with organ transplants, basically probably everybody knows one of you people in that category, they can't be protected. So yes, it's a threat to public health, and it would be very easy and very simple to mitigate this.
Thank you.
Thanks for your question. We're going to head over to the next question.
Yes.
Yeah. So the question will start out crazy and then get serious. Mm-hmm. So. Are zombies still considered to be human beings with all rights in some
yes.
studies?
Yes.
Yeah, and the serious part is, have there been countries who consider to remove human rights from people who suffered from some illnesses, some infectious diseases?
That's a very good point, because as I said here, the purpose is to protect human dignity and human rights. And I was very closely following in 2014 the Ebola outbreak, and here it depends on your nationality. And I remember this example. I couldn't find the source, but there was a person from, I think, Bangladesh, and he was traveling from a non-Ebola country, but nevertheless, and that person was basically quarantined for a very, very long time, and his nationality was Bangladeshi. I'm very sure if that person had been European, or if that person had been had a United States citizenship, he would not have been quarantined for such a long time. Then the human rights issue. It's self-defeating if you do not respect the human rights, because in rich countries you wouldn't need the international health regulations, because frankly our public health system is very strong. But it's a catch-22. When you have poorer countries, like civil war countries with civil war, with a lot of corruption, with a lot of unfair with trade imbalances, people lose trust in the government, and this happened in the Ebola 2014 situation. And the epidemiologists, who were very technical, could not solve the problem. And only when you had the anthropologists coming in and saying, well, wait a second, these people have burial rights, you can't just go there, take them away. I mean, what would you do if somebody with a mask comes to your place, takes away your child? And one of the, so respecting human rights and respecting the dignity is the only way you can create trust in such a situation. What they did, for example, is they made the fences lower, so you could actually see from the treatment areas, they could see each other. It's like you would have two tents there. They gave them free cell phones, so they could call them. So you must maintain dignity and human rights for cooperation, even if you do not believe in human rights. I mean, we all do, but even on a purely technical ground, you must respect human rights to get cooperation. Otherwise, it doesn't work.
Thanks.
Thanks for your detailed answer. The signal angel was signaling, therefore we have a question from outside the tent.
Hi, FG32 Surveillance asks, how well is the Berlin airport prepared for a zombie invasion?
I didn't get it.
There was something with the Berlin airport. Can you just repeat it again? Sorry.
How well, in your opinion, is the Berlin airport prepared for a zombie invasion? B-R-E-R.
Okay, how well is the Berlin airport prepared for circumstances like that? I guess that one airport is really well prepared for that. But are we going to detail for that airport that we have in use at the moment?
I mean, we are in Germany. We love rules. It's the internationale Gesundheitsvorschriftengesetz is quite old. It's from 2012, I think. And the country, the no, I think it's 11. And you must be prepared. And you people want money. And if you say, look, we have new obligations. This is a federal law. We have new obligations. We need to do something. So we need to einstellen, also Job geben, einstellen.
Hire.
We need to hire somebody. So I'm very sure that the Berlin Airport is prepared very well. And the thing is, you need a hospital that can treat highly infectious diseases. And the Charité in Berlin can do that. Then you need a good transport there. And you need a laboratory. The Robert Koch Institute has a biosafety level 4 laboratory that is 24/7. And all this stuff costs a lot of money, and people were actually really keen to implement it because they. But to answer your question, Berlin is prepared, yes. No, I mean, seriously, you have a new law, and the first thing the administration does, oh, we have neue Aufgaben, we have new duties, and for that we need new money. And if it is a federal law, there's nothing you can do against it. You know, it's like, I really need new money. And Munich, for example, my Bavarian colleagues, they got, I think, six positions, which do deal with international health regulation, but at the same time they strengthen the normal surveillance. And I'm really sad that my country, my state, Rheinland-Pfalz, doesn't have an international point of entry, so we didn't get the money the Bavarians got.
All right, thanks for that answer and thanks for the question. We're going to head over here to the tent microphone.
I think, unfortunately, you forgot one vector, which is computer viruses jumping the air gap to the user. So is it then 4-2-3 for the zombies, maybe?
So wait a second. Hold on. So where are we? Here. So for that to work, you would need a computer vector which creates human zombies. Well, okay, I mean, exactly. If you play too much computer, you... Yeah, you're right. I mean, yeah, no, I didn't think of that.
Well,
but
that
it's not
cross
a health
borders.
Risk. It's not a health risk. Oh, yeah, that's the point. It's not a health risk because it does not... okay, you have international spread. Yes, you have international spread. You have an international health... Actually, yes, you're right. I mean, I was hoping for somebody to point out that Michael Jackson had a lot of zombies and Michael Jackson is not heavy metal, but it doesn't work there, yeah.
If you can kill him with propofol, he's not a zombie.
Yeah, he's not a zombie, no.
So that was the famous Zuständigkeitsprüfung
yes.
that you just did?
Yeah.
Excellent. So do we have another question from the internet? We don't. Do we have someone queuing up over here? I can't really see that. No, we don't. Therefore, we're going to end up 6 minutes earlier than expected. Oh, no, there is one question.
Oh,
we're not going to finish there. And for you guys, please queue up behind the microphone. Here we go.
Hello. Thank you very much for your talk. I was wondering if you could say a few words about how the monitoring is done at national and international level, and how does big data come in, mm-hmm. and briefly your pros and cons, maybe. Thank you.
You have to make a distinction. You have to distinguish between low-resource countries and the richer countries. The low-resource countries, a lot of them have the symptomatic surveillance. You do not have the infrastructure of having a laboratory, having a doctor everywhere, and I'm not so sure whether our Western model of having a doctor in a hospital everywhere suits everywhere. But there you would have symptomatic surveillance. For example, for polio, you have the acute flaccid paralysis surveillance everywhere in the world, which The surveillance, when you have a lot of children all of a sudden who have a flaccid paralysis, then you basically detect that and then you jump in, you make an intervention, you find out what's happening there. The richer countries, like Germany, for example, we have this mandatory disease notification. And if we were getting diarrhea, or we were having an outbreak here, the local health department would get all our personal data, which is also good because they are the ones who need to do the contact tracing. They enter the data with your personal data into a central electronic system, which is called SurfNet. And from that moment on, it gets transmitted, but it's transmitted anonymously. So I'm working at a state level health department, and we only get the month of birth, the gender, and the year of birth, and the Landkreis. So there is very strong data protection there, and not even the Robert Koch Institute is, since we are the ones who transmit this data, we don't have this data, they can have this data either. There is a very interesting development called DEMIS, and I see my friends from the Robert Koch Institute cringe a bit, which is reforming the whole process, but that's a different story. And I cannot comment on other countries like UK or like France. But in Germany, it's very good that your local health department knows everything, and they are the ones you interact with. They are the ones you build a trusted relationship. They are the ones who go into your kindergarten when there is an outbreak. They are the ones who go to the schools, and they are the ones who actually do the most important public health work. I'm only crunching numbers.
Florian, from the looks like that was the last question. No one is queuing over here.
Sure.
So, or did I miss someone? No, I didn't. So 3 minutes to go. 3 minutes we're going to close earlier. Florian, thanks for explaining all the zombie apocalypse and the international health regulation. That is your applause. Thanks for your time and thanks for answering all the questions.